Welcome to Peter and Ruffy's Football Show here on TV. The main talking points tonight: Celtic announce that Ronnie Dyla will leave the club in the summer. His reign as Celtic manager is over. David Moyes is the bookies' favourite to replace him. And is Alan Stubbs about to snub Rangers with no guard of honour ahead of the match tonight against Rangers at Easter Road? Just a few of the talking points. The main one, of course, Ruffy, no surprise that we'll be talking about this tonight in the company of our bookroom guest Hugh MacDonald of the Herald. So let's get into the meat and bones of this. Is it about strategic timing based on the fact that season tickets are there to be renewed, Ruffy? Have Celtic acted in case they suffer a financial blow?
Yeah, I think it's just a catalogue of everything, really, Peter. I think you saw the home games in the league. The attendances were really poor. I think the fans would have went away at the weekend feeling absolutely, I think terrible is the word, or something worse than that, you know. So I think they had to act quickly. I think they had to do something, and, you know, he had to go. For me, the biggest downfall for him was he kept using that word progress. And he kept saying to everybody, look, the progress is there for everybody to see. And I think he was just kidding himself on, because I don't think anybody saw any progress. At the end there, the team was a mix and match. There wasn't any continuity in the 11 that he was picking. And he just seemed to have lost it.
Hugh, as far as the straw that broke the camel's back, were you surprised it was as late as a semi-final against Rangers that finally forced the decision?
I thought the decision, and I think in certain ways, I think the decision was made round about Christmas. Certainly, we've been talking all season saying he'll not be there next season, and that now it's hard. But I think the Rangers' defeat was so wretched that I'm actually surprised that he's still in a job at the moment. I thought the Rangers' defeat was so wretched that there was a case for just pulling the plug and saying, thanks very much, but we've got five league games that are crucially important now. This, people forget, this league isn't won yet. I mean, it's all but won, but it's not won. And I thought, maybe just pull the plug on Sunday night, put a caretaker in, and make your plans for next season.
Yeah, Ruffy?
I was going to say, I think if the gap hadn't been 8 points, if it had been two or three, I think there would have been a caretaker manager there, because I don't think the club can take the chance of losing this league.
There is a quote from Ronnie Dyla. We've edited it down, but I think you get the gist of it. It was an absolute privilege to be named manager of Celtic. It is vital that the club comes first, and instead of me being the focus, hopefully now the team and the club can be the focus as we enter this final important period of the season. There have been some disappointments and times when we have not achieved what we had hoped for, and I'm realistic and honest enough to admit that.
Yep. Well, I think that's, you know, that is at least what has happened. You know, there has been huge disappointments. I think this season in particular, there's been moments where, frankly, you don't know what the strategy is. You don't know what he's trying to do. Just as a small point, I mean, everybody and their dog knows that the Rangers' central defence have been losing three goals to a variety of sides through the season. So you'd think the first thing you would do would put pressure on them on Sunday, but there seemed to be no pressure at all in the Rangers, no closing down on them. Danny Wilson sitting pinging 40-yard diagonals. So you're sitting watching that and say, if I see this, what's Ronnie seeing and what's Ronnie going on? And I think in many ways as well, and of course, there's no doubt about it, he was let down by some of his players as well. But that happens to managers when they're on a slide, everything goes.
Yeah, as far as the record is concerned, when you look at the two seasons that he's been in charge, I think the defeats have been telling. They've been crucial defeats. He failed to make the Champions League, Europa League exit, of course, in December, League Cup exit to Ross County, and a Scottish Cup exit to Rangers, I think, put the tin lid on it for many fans, and, of course, the board as well. But the record itself, there were significant defeats. I mean, they were nowhere near Europe, Hugh.
Nowhere near. And I mean, the frightening thing was that in two seasons in Europe, he went out three times, you know, in the Champions League qualifiers. I mean, even when he got a second chance after Legia Warsaw, you know, again made a real mess of that. I mean, after Malmo, there is a case for after Malmo, I think he was a dead duck.
Yeah.
Certainly in this programme after Malmo, I can remember us talking about him saying, well, he'll not survive another scene. You're not. Would you give this man another ticket to the draw? Because this is a huge draw, mm-hmm. the Champions League qualifiers. And I think we all agreed we wouldn't.
Ruffy, there are 5 points here that I think we've been looking at trying to analyse where it all went wrong. Europe, almost certainly. The argument with Chris Commons certainly didn't help matters. And I think his omission has been to the detriment as well. The defence, he hasn't sorted it out in 2 years. The signing policy is shambolic. Mm-hmm. And of course, nobody could second guess his starting 11.
Yeah, I would agree with most of the ones. I'm really interested, you know, to get his view on Chris Commons before he leaves. I would love somebody to actually ask him, you know, what is that all about, you know, because we all know. And it started in the Malmo game when they left him out there, mm-hmm. and everybody was absolutely, how did that happen, sort of a thing. And then he continued to do it in the majority of games. And the odd thing about it is every time Chris Commons came into a game, he scored a goal or practically helped win the game. Mm-hmm. So it's a really interesting one. The defence one, I maybe gave him a bit of slack on. He bought the boy for $3.5 million and has the big centre-half boy and hasn't had the chance to have him in there. Mm-hmm. So it still has been a wee bit of mix and match in the central bit of that defence. But apart from that, you know, that I think not all the players, I think some of the players have just downed tools. And unfortunately, I thought right from the start, you know, bringing an inexperienced manager into a club like Celtic, I never in my wildest dreams could imagine what it is to run a club like Celtic on a day-to-day basis. But coming from where he came from, it was a massive jump for him. Mm-hmm. And I think once he got into the nitty-gritty of it, I think he's realised the magnitude of what it was of being a Celtic manager. And unfortunately, these things happen in the game, and I just don't think he's stepped up to it.
One of the things I think was he wasn't brave enough, you know. If you see when it actually came. I think, see, for the Chris Commons thing, for example, see the Mouldy game when Commons spent about 3 minutes having this extended rant to all, and coming off the park and then having words with him. See, then he should have been told, you're fined the maximum amount of money. You're training with the youth for a month. You'll make a public apology, and then we'll see what's going to happen to you.
Yeah.
But instead, that was all. You know, these things happen. Can you imagine? Can you imagine that happening with a top manager?
Yeah.
Can you imagine that happened with David Moyes? David Moyes at the press conference next day said, "Aye, Chris was just letting off a bit of steam and all that."
Yeah. Was he too nice to be a manager?
That's what I'm saying. He liked that. And the Brown thing, you know, when Scott Brown was pictured in the street with the pizza and all that, had to be hard there, had to be harder with us, and had to be a wee bit braver, sitting thinking, you know what, I've bought Scott Allen, I've bought Ryan Christie, I have to play them, let's have a look at them.
Yeah, if indeed he did.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, what about the next manager? Let's have a look at those odds to see how it's all looking at the moment. Okay, David Moyes, front runner, evens. Neil Lennon has said that he is interested in going back as Celtic manager. You've got Michael O'Neill, Roy Keane, Owen Coyle. Give us your thoughts on that, Ruffy.
I think you have to go for somebody with experience of managing a big club, or somebody who's been at the club before, something like that. The magnitude bit, you know, I think that of dealing with the fans and everything that goes with it, and the players, I think you need a bit of respect as well. So I would go for David Moyes.
Yeah, I'm looking at it though. We know that he's interested in the job. He was on this programme talking about it quite extensively, Hugh. We'll hear from him shortly, but I cannot see Celtic going back to Neil Lennon.
I don't think so either. And I thought, what I did think was that on Sunday night, it crossed my mind that they might have said to him, you know, just leave the Sky Studios, come along to Lennoxdown tomorrow morning, take over to the end of the season.
Yeah.
I could have seen that happening. Long term, I don't know. But they're in a situation, Peter, where it's a really, really difficult decision, because if they go for David Moyes, there's a price to be paid there.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, the other contenders, Michael O'Neill's on a contract, probably doesn't, it's not worth the paper it's written on if they really wanted him. Roy Keane, I couldn't rule it out, Ruffy, if it was Dermot Desmond in there.
Yeah, I know they're mates and that, but it doesn't fit the bill for me. I don't know why it is. Maybe he's too outspoken for me. I just think that, I think, for me, it'd be David Moyes. You know,
yeah.
I just think he ticks all the boxes. But as you're going to show in the interview, the owners of the club will have to tick his boxes for him to take it.
Can you imagine Roy Keane in the press conferences?
I would love it. I mean, as a pressman, you would just love it. It's a pressman's dream. But I can't imagine Roy Keane, you know, being content with the sort of budget that they're going to come up with and the frustrations that he might have along the line as Celtic manager, because there will be frustrations along the way.
Yeah, absolutely. OK, we'll hear from David Moyes in an interview we conducted with him not that long ago, and we will also look to the games tonight, including that one at Easter Road. Is there going to be a guard of honour, or is there a snub coming from the Hibs boss and the players at Rangers? Welcome back to Peter and Ruffy's Football Show here on STV, Monday to Friday, 7 o'clock. And of course, you can watch the repeat at 11 o'clock at night. Not forgetting on a Saturday afternoon, we have a 4-hour show. If you get a chance to join us, we'll bring you all the latest goals, opinion, interviews. Peter and Ruffy's Saturday Football Show on STV Edinburgh and STV Glasgow. Alan Ruff is alongside me, Peter Martin, and our bookroom guest is Hugh MacDonald of The Herald. We were talking about the big story, which is, of course, Celtic have announced that Ronnie Dyla will leave the club at the end of the season. He will remain to try and get Celtic over the line to clinch what will be Ronnie's second title and Celtic's fifth in a row. So if we think Moyes is the favourite, why is he the favourite? Well, a good few weeks ago, Ruffy and myself went to the Hampden Museum and caught up with David Moyes, and this is what he had to say about the Celtic job.
Celtic's been great, great love of mine now, and who knows, I would never say never, but obviously, you know, I've got ambitions to win things, and I would want to be at a club that would give me every chance to win and be involved with the Champions League and be at the top level.
He wants the job. I think there's certain criteria that needs to be met, and I think, you know, if I'm going to be blunt about it, he's not looking for millions. He wants to be able to bring in two or three quality players to supplement the quality that he believes is there, Hugh, and then obviously the big job will be for the rest of the board, maybe the chief executives, to get rid of the freeloaders and time wasters.
Yeah, I mean, there's got to be a clear out there, absolutely. I mean, my understanding from watching that interview in its extended form, he was talking about maybe three marquee players. But the investment would still be significant by Celtic standards. But having said that, it might be a price they just have to pay, because they're a big club in terms of season ticket holders. They want to remain a big club in terms of season ticket holders. And I think season ticket holders will be having very big doubts at the moment about renewing before they decide just in what direction the club wants to go in.
Yeah, if they offload some of the people, I think it's a top-heavy squad of mediocrity, Ruffy. Mm-hmm. Had they gone down a road where the manager decides who comes in to the club and they get those three marquee signings, suddenly, you know, I know there's a ceiling limit of maximum, what, 30 grand a week that they refuse to go over, but you can still get a lot of good quality that can get you into the group stages.
You would like to think it was okay having that format, you know, but you would like to think that these guys are businessmen and are sensible enough to tear it up and start again. You know, that format hasn't worked, you know, and David Moyes, one of the things that he did say was he can work with young kids. You know, that's something he gets a lot of joy out of. But I would think you would need to get the three or four players that you're talking about to establish the team there. But the other thing that he says is he wants to win things, you know, and that's a big, big thing for a manager. Sometimes when you want to win things, you have to put things in the back burner yourself.
And can I kill off the Aston Villa line? You're not going to win things with Aston Villa, or are you going to compete in the Champions League?
No, and I think the big thing for David Moyes, it's in many ways, if you take the financial implications out, in many ways it's a perfect marriage, because David Moyes is smart enough to know that he's had two perceived failures. I actually don't think they were failures, but he's had two perceived failures. He can't afford a third. Aston Villa just screams failure, you know. Celtic doesn't. So I think it would suit David to come in, you know. Again, he's a manager that's not won anything. So he would want to, I mean, he'd have the chance to win something. He was a manager who would enjoy in the Champions League again. So I think it's got its attractions for Davy. Mm. And he's a very wealthy man. He's not going to come here and do it for a charity, but I wouldn't imagine he'd be asking for his top dollar.
No, and of course, the other real attraction here is Rangers.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, there's that's going to be, next season's going to be a hectic season. It's going to be a tough season. But I still think Celtic have got, I mean, even the squad have got now that we poke holes in, I mean, they should have more than enough to do well.
And just on that point, and talking about the challenge and switching our attention to Rangers, Ruffy, you know, you've got the Three Bears and, of course, Dave King saying that they'll put in money and make available somewhere in the region of £5 million for Mark Warburton to try and supplement that squad and get it ready for the Premiership.
Well, again, we don't know what the targets are for next year. He'll be going in there and saying, right, what do you want of me now? I've done everything you've asked me. If you want me to go to another level, if we go to another level, £5 million might not be enough. But what is the level? Do you just want me to go in and be first or second in the Championship? Do you want me to win cups? Do you want me to do well in Europe? And I think the Europe one, he falls into that category. Like Celtic, £5 million isn't going to do anything in Europe.
I can't help but feel that some Rangers fans will say, where's the £30 million eventually?
Now that war chest has been down a hole, hasn't it? I think that's an interesting one. I'll be keeping my eyes very closely on Rangers' investment over the summer. We've got a couple of players coming in from Accrington Stanley. I'm not criticising them because they've bought good players from lower league clubs before that have made a difference. So let's see how they do. But I think, as far as quality goes now, quality costs you a lot of money now, Peter.
Yeah.
And whether it's beyond Celtic and Rangers, or certainly whether it's beyond the ambitions of Celtic and Rangers, will be the crucial question in the summer.
Yeah, absolutely. A real big test. Lots of questions still to be answered over the forthcoming days. Join us if you can. We'll keep you right up to date with what's happening. The other great thing about this country is we always like to look for a little edge to a story. I can't help but feel there's a certain little influence of Shakespeare in the Hibs versus Rangers. Much ado about nothing as far as a guard of honour. I mean, do players really need to be clapped on and, you know, well done from the team that's been chasing you?
I don't think it's a done thing, you know. It's nice to see, you know, but I mean, a guard of honour could be anybody. You know, a guard of honour could be the kids who hold the flags. You know, you can be clapped on. I don't see necessarily why it has to be the actual players in the game. Because if you ask any player of a team coming to the ground, you don't want to be celebrating in somebody else's success. You want to concentrate in the game and win it.
Yeah. We are obsessed with, if it's not a minute's applause, it's a minute's silence, it's a guard of honour, anything at all that can suddenly stoke the flames.
Anything to keep us away from talking about the football, you know? That's really it. And funnily enough, tonight, there's a real football match tonight, real important match. I mean, Rangers, you know, they'll go out luxuriating with their fans after a tremendous performance and result. But Hibs really now, they need to win this, you know, to get back in contact with Falkirk. And that's a huge thing, because no team in that position wants to play an extra two games, especially when they've got a cup final coming up. So it's a smashing game. And there's great background noise to anybody without guard orders, because I think it's fair to say that Warburton and Mr Stubbs are not going to be a two-ball at the next charity golf day. Yeah. So. There's plenty there already.
I mean, the guard of honour looks good. I remember when I was at Partick Thistle with wee Bertie, I think it was Celtic who won the league, and somebody was saying guard of honour, and wee Bertie said, yeah, let's give him a guard of honour. I won't tell you what he said after that.
Okay, answers on a postcard in the competition. So how do you see it going then? Is there an incentive for Rangers just to keep racking up the points? You can see by the table here, you know, they are confirmed as the champions, but Hibs and Falkirk, there is the two games in hand that are crucial, as you mentioned.
You would imagine, you would look at it and say, would Warburton maybe rest a couple of players for the cup final, you know, after the rigours of the weekend? Would he, you know, would Rangers take maybe...
That's a month away.
Yeah, but I mean, take the chance when you've got it, you know, take the chance to... I mean, why throw players in when you don't have to? But I don't think he was, because he tends to stick to his best team all the time. I think there's enough sort of edge there slash almost animosity there to suggest that this will be a full pelt Scottish Cup rehearsal, and I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, what are you going for?
I think Hibs need it more, and I think I think they might just nick it tonight.
Yeah, I think Hibs will just nick it. I think Rangers will rest some players. These two games have been wonderful to play in, and but I'm sure some of them will be feeling like Kenny Miller now, be feeling they need a rest just to recharge the batteries.
Okay, you can join us tomorrow on the programme at 7 o'clock if you get the chance. Just before we go, of course, the main news: Celtic have revealed that Ronnie Dyla will leave in the summer. His tenure as Celtic manager will be over. If you are going to choose one man, if it's a manager, who gets it? If it's a patsy, who gets it?
I think Celtic cannot afford to get this wrong. I think Dermot Desmond has to maybe flash the cash, invest, and I think David Moyes is an outstanding candidate.
Ruffy?
Yeah, of all the candidates, you know, I think if you ask the majority of people, they would say David Moyes.
Okay, give us your thoughts at Peter and Ruffy on Twitter and facebook.com/PeterandRuffy, and you can go on to peterandruffy.com and give us your thoughts as well. We'll reveal more of them on tomorrow night's programme. From Hugh MacDonald, from Ruffy and myself, thanks for watching. Good night.